1968, the year Bill Russell, the NBA's first black head coach, led the Celtics to a world championship. Bob Gibson won the Cy Young Award. Denver's Martin Briscoe became the first African-American starting quarterback. They played in a country that applauded their efforts on the field, yet denied them equality off the field. 1968 may have been 40 years ago, but for many of us, like me, a 19-year-old college student at the time, the events are so vivid, so personal, they could have occurred yesterday. As thousands of lives were lost in Vietnam, decades of discrimination and oppression exploded into streets filled with poverty and rage. This would lead to a bold action by two members of the United States track team, Tommy Smith and John Carlos.
Tommy Smith was the seventh of 12 children, born to immigrant farm workers in Clarksville, Texas. His earliest memories are of working the fields with his family, struggling just to have food on the table. John Carlos was raised in the city, in the hard streets and poverty of Harlem.
Their backgrounds may have been different, but they united to make a statement before the eyes of the world. As Arthur Ashe himself said, "I respected the way they stood tall against the sky and insisted on being heard on matters other than track and field, on matters of civil rights and social responsibility. I couldn't help but admire them."
In a turbulent era, they provided a powerful gesture, a silent statement of pride and unity after so many years of racism and prejudice.
It's hard to explain just how violent the 60s were.
You've got to keep the white and the black separate.
People moving out, people moving in, why? Because of the color of the skin. Room, 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 but you sure can't hide.
Ghost melanation, nigger.
Segregation, determination, demonstration, integration, aggravation, humiliation, obligation to my nation.
1968 was a volcanic eruption at almost every level.
That's what the world is today.
Hey, hey, LBJ, how many cats you killed today?
In the States, that is the shaking of the foundation of American civilization.
We will define black power.
Two major assassinations, Martin Luther King, Bobby Kennedy.
The whole American culture kind of came unhinged.
After a summer of violence and loss, the eyes of the world turned to Mexico City, site of the 1968 Summer Olympics. The games began as a new sense of black consciousness had already taken hold among African-American athletes. There had been talk of an Olympic boycott, but ultimately the athletes decided against it. Still, many of them felt the need to make a statement for human rights during the games.
Not a day passed that somebody did not confront you with, what are you going to do? How are you going to do it? We had this platform, this stage. The world was looking at you, so wham, there it is.
People were really kind of nervous. And nobody was more nervous, of course, than, you know, these old white Olympic officials. I think that everybody was prepared for something stunning to happen.
But who among them would step up? By day four, no one had. Then Tommy Smith and John Carlos took their place for the 200-meter final.
There's Questad. It's a good start. And Carlos, as usual, has burst out of the blocks. Tommy Smith running pretty well so far. And in lane two, Bombouk is strong. On the outside, it's Edwin Roberts. It's John Carlos right now. It's Carlos and Smith. And here comes Tommy Smith. Has done it with his hands in the air.
Tommy Smith had set a new world record. In the tunnel, before the medal ceremony, few words were spoken. They walked to the medal stand with their shoes off to symbolize the poverty of their youth. Tommy Smith accepted the gold medal. John Carlos, the Bronx. As the national anthem began to play and the American flag was hoisted, Smith and Carlos bowed their heads and raised a gloved fist into the night air.
My prayer was a prayer of solidarity, a prayer of hope, that we could unite as a people instead of being separatists in a country that's supposed to be one.
Well, once we turned to leave, I really started thinking hard about, you know, the fact that I was a free man, that they could never put shackles on me again.
They didn't want to be thought just as people who could run faster or jump higher.
A lot of people thought that was just black power. No, that was black people affirming their dignity. So it wasn't anti-American. It was anti-injustice in America.
But for Smith and Carlos, the reaction was swift and severe. They were stripped of their place on the team and sent home by their own country.
The International Olympic Committee said you will either take them off the team by 5 o'clock or you will not be in track and field for the last 2 days of the competition.
Smith and Carlos were vilified as militant radicals, but their personal sacrifice had just begun. There would be death threats and hate mail, and long afterwards, isolation and unemployment. Years of desperation and anguish for themselves and those they loved.
Tommy's career was... couldn't get a job. He ended up moving in with me. He had lost his apartment. His wife had broken up. And he came with a suitcase in his hand.
My parents were being harassed mercilessly, mercilessly. There was real concerns around our safety. So he suffered, and he suffered for years.
It chips away at your manhood. After a while, you get to the point where these things are so prevalent to you, you hate to look at the guy in the mirror in the morning.
It's just amazing how a country can quickly turn, that you win a gold medal for your country, and yet as soon as you take that stand and identify yourself as being proud of who you are, then you're condemned.
4 decades ago, Tommy Smith and John Carlos used their moment of Olympic victory to remind America of a greater battle yet to be won. Now at San Jose State, where they trained together, there's a statue in their honor, a statue that shines a light on our appreciation for their message of human dignity.
They could just as easily have stood there with their hand over their heart, the national anthem playing in the background, but to represent their country and say, I want to run for America, but I want America to understand who I am. It took a lot of courage for them to do what they did, a lot of courage.
I think most black would probably tell you that day was a great day for them, because it probably gave them some hope that, you know, we're going to be able to overcome.
They were willing to sacrifice themselves for something far greater than a gold medal or a bronze medal.
The fundamental lesson of what they did is courage. Courage to think for themselves. And it's the courage to hope, because what they did was, this is a sign of hope. And that's a beautiful thing.